when all desires known, and from him no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and in deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not looked to you from afar. We have not looked to you as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Let us now begin our worship with the singing of hymn number 669, Rise Up, O Saints of God. Hymn number 669 in the back of your worship book.
Rise up, O Saints of God. This is written by Norman Furness, who was born in 1936. It's a fairly modern hymn. The music is by William Walter, American hymn, Rise Up, O Saints of God, from the Lutheran Augsburg Fortress, Lutheran hymn.
Mercy on us, Christ.
Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you show perpetual loving kindness to us, sons of your servants. Because we cannot rely on our own abilities, grant us your merciful judgment, and train us to embody the generosity of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God.
Connie Singleton will be doing the readings today.
Good morning. The first reading is from Jonah, third chapter. But God saw what the people of Nineveh did, how they turned from their evil ways. God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the day. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, it is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about the bush? And he said, yes, angry enough to die. Then the Lord said, you are concerned about the bush for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, the great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals? The word of the Lord.
Two.
My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress in joy and faith, so that I may share abundantly in your boasting in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or I'm absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. For them, this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege, not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well. Since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Time for the reading of the gospel. Our pastor, Pastor John Pollock, will be reading the gospel for today. It has to do with God's generosity. God is generous and loving to us no matter what. Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord, and our Savior, loving kindness. Read by Pastor Pollock.
of an envious eye. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. There were two eagles. One eagle could fly higher than the other one and could fly farther than the other one for a longer period of time. And this made the other eagle very envious of him. So one day the envious eagle was flying and he saw a hunter. So he flew down to the hunter, and this hunter happened to be an archer. And he said, "You know what I would love? I would love for you to shoot your arrow and knock that eagle up there out of the sky." And the archer said, "Well, I can do that. I just need a feather for my arrow." So the eagle plucked a feather out of his wing and he gave it to the archer and he put it onto his arrow and he fired the arrow up at the eagle that was the source of envy of the other one. And the arrow missed because it couldn't go high enough as the eagle was flying. So the envious eagle asked him to try again. And he said, "Well, I need another feather." And so he plucked another feather out of his wing, and the archer shot his arrow and again missed. And this went on, continuing, until it got to the point that the envious eagle could no longer fly because he had pulled so many feathers out of his wing. So you can imagine what happened next. The hunter looked at the eagle in the sky. He looked at the one at his feet that couldn't move, so he killed the one at his feet and took it home. The moral of the story is, when we have envy for someone, we can do more damage to ourselves than to the one of whom we are envious. Envy, that is what Jesus is addressing in our gospel lesson. As we read that 20th chapter in the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus begins with a parable. And he begins with some very important words that you need to always be aware of if Jesus are saying these before giving a parable, or if he just starts a parable off saying, like a man went out to sow. But he begins by saying, the kingdom of heaven is light. When Jesus says that, he is speaking to you and me. He's speaking to his disciples. He's speaking to his church. He is speaking to his followers. He's not speaking to the whole world. He's not speaking to secular society. And so we cannot expect secular society to do what he's going to tell us to do. This is instructions for us. The idea is that hopefully our influence then will bring others to Jesus Christ, so society will become more and more Christianized and eventually adopt this type of behavior. But Jesus said we'd always have opposition, so not everyone is going to join into the community of faith. And so we have to be careful when we are in some kind of a discussion, and we want to make a point, and we want to use some of Jesus' words to make sure we're not using words that Jesus is applying only to the community of faith and not to the whole world. There have been some presidents that, in order to try to push their point across, will have quoted Jesus. But unfortunately, at times, the quote they use has been words which Jesus was directing just to the community of faith, not to an entire nation. And so the quote didn't really back up the president's point he was trying to make. So, Jesus is speaking to us. The kingdom of heaven is like a owner of a vineyard who goes out and agrees with laborers for the usual daily wage and sends them into his vineyard. This was a common practice in Jesus' day. My understanding, this is still a practice out west. Some of your big farms, vegetable farms, fruit farms, that farmers will go out to certain areas where people, daily workers, will be standing around and they will hire them to go into their fields and then pick the crop for the harvest. And so, these fellas are hired The owner then goes back out at noon and at 3, and then at 5. And he asks the guys, why are you sitting around and standing around here idle all day? And he says, well, nobody would hire us. So he hires them to work the last hour or two of the workday. So as we look at this parable, then we see when it comes paying time that those who were hired first become very envious of those who were hired after them. When they see them being paid in the denarius, they just automatically assume they will be paid more because after all they work. But then they're only given the denarius and they begin to grumble. And the landowner says, I'm not cheating you. You agreed to work for a denarius. That's what I'm paying. So what we see then is this envy by those who were first hired. And that brings us to the first point of the danger of an envious eye. What is it a day? Why is it a danger? Why is Jesus warning us about this? It's because, first of all, the first danger of an envious eye is that it obscures our original blessing. We become so envious that we forget the blessing that we've been given. The blessing was that these fellows were hired and hired first. They didn't have to wait. They didn't have to worry if that day they were going to be able to put food on their family's table. They didn't have to wait any longer that day if they were going to have money to buy supplies they might need. They weren't going to have to worry anymore if they were going to be able to put some cash into the family piggy bank. They had been blessed by being hired first. But when we become envious, we oftentimes forget those blessings. And so that was the original blessing, to be hired. The landowner said that he would pay him a denarius, and we read, after agreeing to labor with the laborers for the usual wage, he sent them into the vineyard. That word agreeing, it means to be suitable. It means to be harmonious. It means to concur. So all these laborers, however many there were, all concurred that this was a fair wage. They all said it was suitable. They were in harmony. They were in agreement. We'll do this. And so they had been blessed. But their envy causes them to forget that blessing. And it's the same thing with us. If we become envious of a brother or sister in the church, then it is easy for us to forget the blessings we've received. And we don't think anything about the blessings. All we think about is how they're doing something, or they got something that we deserved, or that we wanted, or that should have happened our way, or whatever. So you forget. Be thankful to God for what you have. And so, an envious eye causes us to be obscure about our original blessing. And we think we deserve more, whether really or not we do. The second danger of an envious eye is that it cannot rejoice at the blessing of others. Jesus calls us to be different than the world. In the world, you're taught to look out only for you. Look out for number one. You are taught to strive for something, and you do so much that you're entitled to that, or it should be given to you. And then when you don't receive it, then you become very upset and very angry, and you don't rejoice, and you don't congratulate those who receive what you thought you should receive. And although that may be a common tactic in society, Jesus is saying that within the community of faith, in the church, we are not to be like that. We are not to be jealous that somebody leaps over us for some position, but instead rejoice for them. In the church, in assembly, whenever there is a bishop election, the idea is, just like Satan calling a pastor, that the Holy Spirit is at work. And that the Holy Spirit guides, in case of electing a bishop, that the Holy Spirit guides the assembly to vote for the person who becomes the new bishop. It's called ecclesiastical ballot. There's no campaigning. There's no putting people's names in nomination. You're given a blank piece of paper and told to write down who do you think the next bishop should be. And that first ballot, very rarely is anyone elected. Usually the first ballot is considered a nominating ballot. And everybody who gets a vote is into the next round. And in the next round, you vote, and then there's a cutoff spot after the second round as to you had to receive a certain percent to go into the third round. And as each round goes, you need fewer and fewer votes. At first, it has to be almost unanimous. Second, it's like two-thirds. Then it gets down to a little bit more than half, and then the final ballot is a half. 50% plus one. But the whole idea is the Holy Spirit's working. So if you're in the running, but you don't win, you should rejoice for the person who did win. Well, when I was first ordained back in 1978, that spring, my synod, the Indiana Kentucky Synod, was having an election for a new bishop. And there was a fellow who had been an assistant to the bishop, who was retiring, who thought he should be the new bishop. And he was expecting to be elected. Well, he wasn't elected. And so, instead of rejoicing and congratulating the winner, he immediately left the Indiana Kentucky Synod for another synod, because he didn't want to be there since he had lost. That's what envy does. And we're supposed to be representatives of the church and of Jesus Christ. So we should handle something like that better than in the secular world. But you've seen political candidates handle loss better than that, assistant to the bishop. So an even envious eye causes us not to rejoice for the blessing of others. And causes us to want to compare ourselves to them with the idea of making ourselves look better. That's the whole reason to compare, usually, so that you can look better. As the first workers hired said, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who bore the burden of the day in this scorching heat." Now, looking at it from a secular perspective, they had a right to be upset. From a secular perspective, they bore the heat of the day, they worked all the hours, and yet the landowner is now paying them the same, making them equal in his eyes. Secular world will see that totally as unfair. But we're dealing with God and salvation, not with secular economics. See, because remember, Jesus says the kingdom of heaven is like. And so he is also talking about the fact, not just that you may be in the church for a long time and you may be overlooked for something that you wanted, but he's also talking about people coming to the kingdom late. In our tradition, we usually come into the church as a baby, being baptized. God adopts us as his child. The Holy Spirit plants the seed of faith in our heart. Our parents are supposed to instruct us in the Christian faith and bring us to God's house for worship. And then we reach a certain age and we go through confirmation and we proclaim that faith for ourselves. Other people don't come to the church until they're 30 or 40 or 50 or 80 or on their deathbed.
And we could say that same man, that same attitude. I've been a Christian all my life. Why should this person get to enter the kingdom of heaven on their deathbed, having lived their entire life Antichrist? Not being the Antichrist, but being the anti-Christian by their lifestyle and by their behavior. It's like the thief on the cross, that first Good Friday. He spent his entire life violating every one of the Ten Commandments, violating every one of the Jewish oral laws. He didn't abide by anything but what he wanted, and yet there, nailed to a cross, his lifeblood flowing out of him, death descending on him, he turns to Jesus and acknowledges Jesus as his Lord and Savior. Acknowledges the fact, confesses his sin, I'm receiving what I deserve because of my life. But you do not deserve to die with us. And what does Jesus say to him? Today, you will be with me in paradise. Now, he's one that was hired at 5 o'clock. And yet he is treated the same as us who are hired at the beginning of the morning. But again, we are dealing with salvation. We are dealing with God and what God wants. And so an envious eye causes us to question God and to dispute God because of his mercy. The first hired, instead of thanking God for their good fortune that had befallen them by being hired, instead of being left until the very last hour before the day was over, they had been hired at the very beginning, easing their conscience, not having to worry about getting the job. Those poor guys that were there at 5 o'clock, by the time the landowner found them, had to be down in the dumps because, like, oh, another day and we're not hired. How am I going to feed my family? How am I going to pay the rent? How am I going to buy food at the marketplace? How am I going to buy Junior a new pair of sandals? You know, those guys had to feel awful, but the landowner comes and he shows them mercy. He shows them the generosity. And that is the point Jesus is making about our Heavenly Father, that he is generous. And he acts out of generosity, which brings us to the third danger of an evil eye, and that is it frowns on the generosity of God. It frowns on the generosity of God. Fellows are grumbling. The landowner says, I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? Or, as it says in the original Greek, do you have the evil eye? The word allowed means it's legal, it's proper. So the landowner, of course, represents God and our Lord Jesus Christ. And we're talking about the kingdom, which is their gift to give to whomever they want. And so they're saying to us, if we're going to grumble about people who have deathbed confessions and have a place in heaven, or if we're talking about people who are like a mass murderer who is sentenced to death and is on death row, and on death row he converts and becomes a Christian or repents of all his sins, and we think, why should he get to go into heaven with all the tragedy that he caused and all the horror he caused me? It's because God is generous. He says, is it not legal that I do with what's mine, whatever I want? Is it not proper? And it is. It's God's. We have no claim on it. We cannot tell God what to do because we're not perfect. We all sin and fall short of the glory of God. making restrictions about who he allows into heaven. Where does he start and where does he stop? What do you do? How many things wrong can you do before it's a cutoff and you can't get in? If God acted that way, it wouldn't be grace. It wouldn't be mercy. It wouldn't be generosity. The word envious means to be wicked or to be malicious. Or are you envious? Are you wicked? Are you malicious? Because I am benevolent. And that is a question we have to ask ourselves sometimes. How do we feel? Are we being wicked and malicious when we think there's somebody that doesn't deserve heaven because of the way they live? Sunday school class this morning, the question was asked, what would it be like to get to heaven and find Hitler there? You know, all the millions of people that he caused to die. But if he repented at the last moment, I doubt very seriously it happened. He pretty much disowned the Christian faith as the ruler of Nazi Germany and embraced German paganism as his religion. I doubt very seriously that Stalin's there from what we hear how Stalin died. But just suppose it would be there. Imagine the shock we would have. But the reality is that the kingdom of heaven is not a matter of fair play, but of astonishing generosity. Now that's not one of your questions on your sheet, but you ought to write it at the bottom of your sheet. Because this is a point you should remember above all about this parable. It's teaching us that the kingdom is not about fair play, but astonishing generosity. And that's how God is. Astonishingly generous. Overlooking all of our sins so that we can enter into the kingdom. Overlooking all of our warts and blemishes so that we can be part of his eternal kingdom with all those who come before us in the faith. So, the envious eye prevents us from having an end. An envious eye does not let us appreciate that astonishing generosity that God has for all of us. That evil eye does not allow us to recognize that the astonishing generosity that God showed us through giving us his son, Jesus Christ, to suffer and die upon that cross, to pay the debt of sin that we have. Imagine. Or it's hard to imagine. A one death on a cross. Nearly 2,000 years ago. Brings the salvation of the whole world. If only you will believe. So let us not be like that eagle that was so envious of its neighbor that it brought about its own destruction. But instead, let us be thankful for the generosity of God. Let us be thankful for the generosity of our Lord Jesus Christ. And when that old envious eye tries to raise its ugly head, let us be sure to push it back and remember that except for the grace of God, there will be. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Let us now sing, Jesus Calls Us Over to Him All, hymn number 696, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 696.
This hymn was written, the words were written by Mrs. Cecil Francis Alexander. Her husband was the publisher of this hymn, Jesus Calls Us. She wrote it to make the Bible more understandable to children. She was a Sunday school teacher and wrote this as a Sunday school song. Mrs. Cecil Frances Alexander, lived in the 1800s. Time for offering. You're watching our service, St. John's Lutheran Church. This is September 24th, 2017, the 16th Sunday after Pentecost. The ushers are now giving out the offering plates and taking up the offering. St. John's is its corner of Wittenberg in Columbia. We invite you to come to our services at 8 o'clock, 10:30, Sunday school at 9:15 for all ages. This is something that you can do to spend an hour with God, and you will then be able to be with God the whole week long. This is a good beginning. Sunday, September 24th today, come and worship with us. Receive God, receive the Holy Spirit. We can know God through His Scriptures, through the Holy Spirit, and also through Jesus' presence in Holy Communion, and through our relations with other people. Love God, love one another. We confess, we repent, we do what Jesus asks. We pray that we're not envious of other people. This was the sermon today. Don't be envious. We have many things going on here at the church. We have quilts today. that are being sent abroad to all the people who are in need. Many quilts made by the members of our church. You see now the ushers going forward, receiving the offering. We will now have the following, the rest of our service. This is our service of the word, so we don't have communion today. We have communion the first and third Sundays of each month, festivals, and every Wednesday evening. At Wednesday evening service in the chapel at 6:30, you receive communion, Holy Communion. Music was written by Anthony Showalter, who was a gospel musician and a music teacher, and he wrote over 130 music books. He's from Dalton, Georgia, Presbyterian, and his friend Elijah Hoffman wrote the words. They wrote in response to one of the pupils who lost his wife and they wanted to comfort him, and they wrote this song. Watching us on YouTube, spread the word. You can worship with us. You can receive Holy Communion with us, because God is capable of doing anything that we ask. We can watch on television. We can virtually receive the body of Christ, body and blood of Christ. We believe that He's truly present. He fills us with His grace. We receive communion. He fills us with His love. His love overflows in us. Fill our cup, Lord. Fill it up. Fill it up with love. Fill it up till it overflows. Flowers today are given by Jerry and Phyllis Cochran in honor of Lori, Michelle, and Linda's birthdays. Also anonymously given to the glory of God. The flowers, you've seen them on the through the broadcast. Beautiful flowers. We have fresh flowers every Sunday, and we appreciate the people who give them. Also, we have the quilts here that were made by, many quilts made by the ladies here at the church and being sent abroad to all the people who need it to the Lutheran Church. We thank you for coming to our service. We're at the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia, right across from Springfield Regional Hospital, and also next to the Ohio Surgical Center, Ohio Valley Surgical Center. So we're right between two medical centers. And we invite you to come and worship with us anytime. It should be easy for you to find us. We're at 8 o'clock in the morning every Sunday, except during the summer. We are at this drive-in service. And we are now back in the sanctuary, 8 o'clock. We're also at 10:30, corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. We invite you to pray for us, pray for our ministry. We serve 8,000 meals a month. Come help us do this. Help the poor, help the people in our neighborhood, help the people in the world. Love God, love your neighbor, just as He commands you to do. Repent, believe, love God, love your neighbor. We thank you for worshiping us. Spread the word and watch this every Sunday.